all the Bible is the Word of God, but not all the Bible is equally important to your Christian life. Now, every Christian ought to read all the Bible, but not every Christian ought to obey all the Bible. Now, the reason I say that is there are some parts of the Bible that were written to the Jews. For instance, you are not supposed to take a Passover lamb to Jerusalem during the time of the Passover and put it over your doorpost. You know better than that. Christians are not under the dietary laws that Israel were under. It's not a sin for you to eat catfish. It was for a Jew. It's not a sin for you to eat bacon and eggs. It was for a Jew. So all the Bible was written for you to read, but not all the Bible was written for you to obey. And the reason people get in serious trouble in religion is they don't know what part of the Bible they're supposed to obey. You have to rightly divide the Word of God. Listen to what it says. It's misquoted most of the time. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing. The only way that you can show yourself approved unto God is to rightly divide the Bible. You don't show yourself approved just by studying. You can study and not rightly divide the Bible. Now, the Bible is divided into three classes of people. The Bible was written to the Jew. And part of the Bible was written to Gentiles, or about Gentiles and to Gentiles. And part of the Bible was written to born-again believers. Now, if you don't know whose mail you're reading, you're liable to get in trouble. If I find a check, it might be a good check. But if I try to cash it, it would be embezzling funds. Nothing wrong with the check. Just got the wrong name on it. So we need to understand this thing about the Bible. That's why you have so many cults. That's why you have all this nonsense going on in America today and around the world. You can take almost everything that's being taught in any kind of so-called Bible religion today, almost any of them, they are teaching a truth that is misplaced. Almost every heresy is a truth misplaced. For instance, David Koresh down in Waco. First of all, his name's not David or Koresh. But anyway, you know, I mean, the guy may have some mental problems. I don't know. I don't know that much about him. But I know a little bit about what he teaches and what he believes. And you know what the major problem is? He has no idea which part of the Bible applies to the body of Christ today. So he thinks that he is the seventh angel over there in the book of Revelation, and that's supposed to preach to Israel and start a world, get them converted and start a world war and so on. You know, it's bizarre. But you see, what he's done is he's taken a truth out of the book of Revelation, applied it to himself. Now, almost every cult does that. That's why you have the Seventh-day Adventist people today. Seventh-day Adventists. I'm not saying they're bad people. I'm not talking about people's value. And some of you folks think that I am. I'm not. They may be better people than us. And most Seventh-day Adventists are better than Baptists. See? You check with their insurance companies and you'll find out that an insurance agent would rather insure a Seventh-day Adventist than a Baptist. You check it out and find out why. So I'm not talking about value of people. Nobody's, you know, I mean, you and I are no more valuable than anybody else when it comes to value. I'm talking about Bible teaching. The Seventh-day Adventists, where do they come from? They're a group of people that believe that they are spiritual Israel. And they therefore believe that all the commandments to the Jews in the Old Testament apply to them today. Therefore, today they worship on Saturday, they abstain from pork, and they apply all the dietary laws. Now, also they teach that going to church on Sunday is the mark of the beast. So all of you people here today are destined to hell, because if you have the mark of the beast, you're lost. Now, don't get upset at me. I know what I'm talking about. You don't know what I'm talking about. See? So you need to go study this before your blood pressure gets up, you see. It just shows how narrow-minded you are. See, I'm far more liberal, far more broad-minded than you. See? And far more tolerant. See? I know what I'm talking about. Now, the same thing would be true with many other groups, such as the Mormons. They believe that, I better not get on the Mormons. They're too close. Let's get on them, okay? Anyway, no. All I'm trying to say. Now, by the way, the thing is now, you see, I could go out here and talk about neighbors. But the same thing is true with many Baptist groups. Some of our Baptist brethren aren't doing much better. See? They don't know the difference in John the Baptist and the Apostle Paul. They don't know the difference in the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of the grace of God. See? That doesn't mean they aren't saved. They are saved, and thank the Lord for them. But the problem is this matter of being able to know what belongs to you. You see? The charismatic movement would die if they could rightly divide the Bible. It would die in a moment. But you see, they think that the kingdom promises. And by the way, I picked up a book here recently down at one of the bookstores, and it says, I'm a king's kid. I started reading it. I never finished it. I just took it and threw it in the garbage. I don't think I read through the first chapter. Because the premise in this book was that the kingdom ministry belongs to the body of Christ today. And that's where this prosperity theology is coming from. And the only people prospering from prosperity theology are the people on television who are teaching it. I can tell you that. Okay. You probably won't get rich if you get saved and start tithing. You see, you probably won't. You probably won't. I hope you do and keep tithing. It helped me. But, all right. However, there are some areas, listen to me, there are some areas where God does not discriminate between anybody. There's no difference. And this morning I want to talk to you on God's indiscriminate conclusion. You read it in verse 22 of our text, Galatians 3:22. Notice he says, but the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. You'll notice, first of all, that this matter of the indiscriminate God is a scriptural conclusion. You will notice that the authority of the scripture. Now, our problem today in America and in the world is there is no authority. People resent the word authority. They rebel, they recoil against it. Nobody today has any authority. How dare you even talk about authority? Authority is taken from the home to where the parents cannot discipline children. And I'm against child abuse. And if you're abusive of children, sexually or any other way, they ought to put you in a hole so deep they have to pipe light to you. So now then, we're kind of clear on what I think about this, okay? I raised 5 children, and no child should ever be abused. But the real problem is that sometimes children need to be corrected. And what is happening is because of the abuse of this correction, laws are now being established, and they're going overboard to where many parents are scared to make their children mine, and now children 3 and 4 and 5 years old can take their parents to court and divorce them. Now listen, it may be true that some children need, or somebody needs to step in when abuse is going on, but I'm telling you what, it is a dangerous state of affairs when parents have been handcuffed and they cannot be parents to their children. You don't realize what that does to a society. And when children are fed constantly that, you know, your parents can't make you mine, your parents can't keep you from dating, your parents can't tell you when to come home, your parents can't discipline you, you know what you're raising? You're going to raise a bunch of rebels. Now, God gave parents to kids to train them and correct them. That's why God gave parents. I mean, the animal kingdom's got more sense than that. You know that, don't you? I mean, when an old cow gets ready to wean a baby calf, she'll kick it right in the head. Those of us who are raised on farms, we know how that works. So you don't know that. You think milk comes from a grocery store. See? No, it comes from cattle. And an old Jersey cow has enough sense that when it comes time to wean that baby calf, that calf's going to get weaned. I've watched them. And she'll bring that hind foot up and she'll kick that calf right under the chin. See, I don't think you're going to nurse today. How cruel. We start killing cows the next thing you know because of that. You take an eagle. When an eagle gets ready for the baby to get out of the nest, it's getting out of the nest. Parents haven't learned that yet, including this preacher. Now I'm just kind of... I get to preaching and forget where I'm at. But they ought to get out of the nest. Lord, deliver me. I don't know what I'm doing here. Kind of losing my mind this morning. Okay. This matter of authority is necessary. Now listen, authority doesn't mean that anybody's better than you. That's not the purpose of authority. Authority means that there's structure. Now, if you didn't have structure to your skeleton and have some muscle to hold it together, you'd be a pile of bones on the floor. There has to be structure. And the way a community or a church or a home or a business collapse is when the structure is taken away. And you can't have structure without authority. It's impossible. If you think that you're going to get married and there's going to be two heads in your home, you're crazy. It's not going to work. Now, there may not be a head, and then you confuse it and think it's two heads. But there won't be two. It's impossible. It's impossible. And the same thing's true in a business. The same thing's true in a church. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. It has a head. And a body that doesn't have a head is dead. Just like your home, like a government. Now then, there must be authority. I don't mean authority is always right. I don't mean that. I don't mean that just because there's authority that good things are going on. I don't mean that. But I'll tell you what, an organization with authority where things are not going as they should will accomplish more than an organization with no authority. I mean, it's just that way. And to America today is at a place to where there's no authority. It's a joke. And the way you bring anarchy is to destroy authority. Now, do you understand that? Well, if you do you understand what's going on in this country? It's all by design. Now, God has an authority. It is not the pastor. It is not the pope. It is not the cardinals or the bishops. It is not the deacons. Here is the authority. It's in a book. See? Now, this is why the world hates this book, and that's why the world keeps trying to rewrite it. And what they're doing is trying to take the authority out of it so that it reads like a Reader's Digest. Now, reading any other Bible, as far as I'm concerned, is like trying to shave with a banana. You know, it may be smooth, but it won't take any beard off. This book wants to take the hair off of you. And that's why folks don't like it. It's a two-edged sword. The wonderful thing about this book is it's a hammer that breaks a rock in pieces, but it's also honey. See, there are times when people need honey, right? Some of you ladies looked at your husbands, okay. There are times when folks need some honey, but there are other times when folks need a hammer. See, but they don't need the honey all the time, and they don't need the hammer all the time. So the Bible was written to give you just what you need, and you'll get what you need if the whole counsel of God is preached. See? But some of you drop in every once in a while, and all I'm doing is hammering, and you think that's all we do 52. We don't. We Christmas and Easter, we do something else. Now, the reason I say that, if you look at our text in verse 22, it says, "The Scripture hath concluded." The Scripture hath concluded. The Scriptures are the final authority. They have concluded. But you say, I thought God was the final authority. Listen, the interesting thing is that you can't separate God from the Bible. I tell you what, you study God and the Bible will have every attribute that God has. Because the Bible is God's Word. So you can't separate the Bible from God. People would like to. Then they wouldn't have an authority. They would become their own authority. They would set aside the Bible and they'd say, well, my authority is God. Oh, and how does your God talk to you? Well, he talks to me through my feelings, and he talks to me through the nature, and he talks to me through... You see how that works? So they close the Bible, and then they become their own authority depending on what kind of heartburn they're having. See? The authority for the child of God is a written book. It's a book. And most of you, bless your heart, you mean well, but you have bought a Bible that is nothing but a Jehovah's Witness Bible. And if you compared it with a Jehovah's Witness, you'd find out it's 99.9% the same. Why? Because the devil hates the Bible. The devil doesn't care if you have church. He doesn't care if you have a religion. He cares if you have an authority that will point you to God. In Galatians, look at Galatians 3:8, just back a few verses from the chapter you're in. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 8, it says the scripture foreseeing. Now that's an entry. Did you look at that verse? Notice it says the scripture foreseeing that God would. Well, it's talking about the scripture as having eyes and having intelligence, that the scripture's foreseeing. It didn't say foretelling. No, it's foreseeing, like a prophet. And the scripture concluded. So the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith preached the gospel unto Abraham. Therefore, you and I must find out what the scriptures say about any matter. It's to the law and the prophets, the Bible says. The Bible says if they speak not according to this book, it's because there's no light in them. And you can speak according to this book, but if you don't rightly divide it, there's still no light. You can prove anything from the Bible. All right? So the scriptures themselves are the final conclusion. Did you ever wonder why when a president is sworn in, he puts his hand on a Bible? Did you ever wonder why you're taken into court and you swear? Matter of fact, years ago, you put your hand on the Bible, you swear in a court. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing. You know what you're doing? You're swearing by the highest authority known to man. Right there. Did you ever think about that? It's this book. It's this book. Governments. You read the Old Testament, you'll find out that kings, in the Old Testament, kings were to have a copy of this book. Some of our forefathers that you probably don't know about, they said no man can rightly govern a nation apart from this book. You watch what happens to nations that try to govern without it. You watch. All you got to do is look around. We've got a government right now that's trying to govern without this book. And you watch where we're headed. Now, your opinion and my opinion won't even be considered at the judgment seat. The Bible is the final authority in all matters relating to God, man, governments, heaven, hell, salvation. And our opinions mean nothing. They're just so much smoke. They're nothing. I had a little Bible study. I was on vacation a few years ago and down in Astoria, or down on the coast, down in Oregon coast. And on a Wednesday night, I went to a little Baptist church and there was about 15 or 20 people seated over here, and my wife and I came in, and all of these people sitting around with a different version of the Bible on their hand, in their lap, and one of them said, "Well, what does your version say?" And they would read it. And another one would say, "Well, what does yours say?" And they would read it. And this went on with about a half a dozen people. And then when it was all through, the pastor could say, "Well, they're all nice. They're all nice." Now, where was the authority in that group? They didn't have it. Let me ask you a question. How many of you got a watch on this morning? Okay. What time is it? What time you got? You got 11 to 12. What time do you have? One of you folks on the front over here. What? You got a quarter till. He got 11 to. We already got a conflict here. Okay. Anybody got any different time? 12? It ain't going to work, brother. You mean 12 to 12, I hope. You better get that thing fixed. Anybody got anything different? What? 13 to. Got to watch the 13s. 10 to. Now, listen. Do you notice? Now, anybody want to tell us really what time it is? You know what time it is? You don't know what time it is. You wouldn't know what time it was unless you called Greenwich, England. You don't know what time it is. I bet that galls people to know that over in England, that's where the final authority on time is. That's the final authority on time. Your watch is not the final authority. If you've got a Rolex, it doesn't make any difference. Your watch is not the final authority. The final authority for time is in England. And of course, England sets it by the stars. And we know who made the stars. So we know where the final authority for time is, don't we? It's in heaven. He's the author of time. What I'm trying to get across to you is if your Bible is not the final authority, then you're the final authority. And then we know who your daddy is. Amen? Good preaching, Brother Blue. Okay. Now, that's point number one. And by some people's clock, it's already 12 o'clock. Secondly, not only is there this the scriptural conclusion in verse 22 of our text, but you'll notice that it's a settled conclusion. You'll notice that the Bible makes this comment in the past tense. The scripture hath concluded. This is not some conclusion that's going to take place at the judgment seat. I used to think before I got saved, I used to believe or think, I had no basis for it, I thought, believed, that when I died or when we died, God would hold a pair of balances up here, and all of my good works would be over here, and my bad works would be here, and my good would outweigh my bad, and I'd be able to go to heaven. How many of you thought that way? Something like that? Most of you. Listen, that's what I thought. I thought, therefore, that whether I would be lost or saved would be determined at the judgment after I died. But let me tell you, whether you're going to go to hell or heaven was decided back there in Adam. Now listen. Notice it says in our text, the scripture hath concluded all under sin. Now you notice it doesn't say under sins, plural. It's under sin. It's under the principle of sin. It's under the law of sin. It's under the master of sin. That is the sinful nature. And the scripture hath concluded that the whole human race is already under sin. That's why you don't ever have to teach anybody to do wrong. It's natural. We have a natural bent to do wrong. It's our tendency. It's a tendency to do wrong. A child left to himself brings his mother to shame. You don't have to do anything. Just leave him alone. Same. So the scripture hath concluded, it's a settled matter. And in John 3:18, it says, he that believeth is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. I picked up a little gospel pamphlet some time ago, and on the front page it said, what you must do to go to hell. And I opened it up, and it was blank on the inside. And what a shock. I didn't have to do anything. I looked at the back page, and it explained that I'd already done it. Notice again that it's a universal conclusion. The scripture hath concluded all under sin. This issue doesn't deal with a select few. It's everybody. I don't care how moral degenerate you may be or how impeccable you may be, you're still under sin. You were born that way. You see, some people, their sins are degenerate. Other people, their sins are pride. Station is important to them. But they're still an abomination to God because they defy God. One has to do with the flesh. The other one has to do with the pride of life. And all that's in the world is the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life. And God abhors all of them. See, some of you, I was listening to Dr. Ruckman one time. He was talking about, he says, when America destroys the middle class, the church is done. When the middle class is destroyed, the church is done. And the reason for that is that if a church is going to send missionaries and build Christian schools and Bible colleges, they must have money. And that money comes from the middle class. It comes from the middle class people. A church cannot survive on people in total poverty if it's going to do those things I just mentioned. On the other hand, a church can't survive with all rich people. Because rich people want to run the church because of pride and station and possessions. So both of them are a real problem in a church. And so the sins may have to do with immorality, they may have to do with degeneracy, or they may have to do with pride and rebellion and arrogancy against God. Both of them are a sin. So God has just put everybody in the same package and said all are condemned under sin. That includes Baptists and Presbyterians and Methodists and Lutherans and everybody else. Makes no difference. Men, women, boys and girls, red, yellow, black and white, they are sinners in His sight. Makes no difference. Same. Notice again, though, in our text, if you will, in this same verse, I'm in chapter 3 and verse 22, you'll notice that there is a merciful conclusion. How appropriate Psalm 136 is to our subject this morning. Notice the last part of this verse says that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to all them that believe. Now, you may not realize the importance of that statement, but let me show you this. You see, when a sinner realizes the total ramification of his condition as a sinner, he cries out. I had cancer when I was 31. I had colon cancer. Now I hadn't, prior to that, folks, I hadn't given 5 minutes thought to cancer. I hadn't given 5 minutes thought to it. I was feeling rather sickly. I went to a doctor. He diagnosed and he found I had a tumor the size of a golf ball in my colon, total blockage. It had already eaten through the colon wall and some of the seeds of it were out in the other parts of my body. All of a sudden, I became nothing but cancer conscious. All of a sudden, day and night, I am now cancer conscious. Now I have some information I didn't have before. I had the cancer before. I probably had it a year before. Maybe 3 years before. Matter of fact, Dr. Chapman said that just a small, one of those small, what do you call them? Polyps. He says it takes about 3 years for them to become a full-blown cancer. And so obviously I had this tumor for over 3 years, but I had no conscious of it. So there was no concern. I didn't need a doctor. Didn't feel my need. But all of a sudden, I'm made aware of my condition. Now I'm studying, I'm praying, I'm talking to people, I'm conscious. Every time I have a pain, I'm cancer conscious. Even to this day, when I have some kind of something that doesn't function just right, that consciousness is there. I'm talking about it this morning. I think about it every day of my life. What has happened? All of a sudden, I've been made aware of a problem. Now, you know why folks today cannot appreciate the grace of God and the mercy of God? You know why they can't appreciate it? Because they can't grasp their condition of being lost. They can't get it. They cannot get it. And I don't think you'll ever get it unless the Spirit of God reveals it to you. I don't believe it. I can sit in this thing and preach about the fact that if you're not born again, you're going to go to hell. That you're cut off from God. That all your righteousness are like filthy rags. There is none good, no, not one. There is none that seeketh after God. They've all gone out of the way. They've all together become unprofitable. There is no fear of God before their eyes. And there may be somebody in here who'll set up and listen to that and say, that fits me. But I'm telling you what, 75 to 80% of the people say, that doesn't match me. See? Now, to whom much is forgiven, he loves much. You know why some people can't really love God? Because they aren't forgiven anything. Dr. Chapman is my doctor. I got him on the phone, talked to him the other day. Finally, he has Bibles. He gives. I was looking for a Bible for some Filipinos, a special dialect. And Dr. Chapman has these Bibles that he gives to patients. And he had about four dialects for the Filipinos, but he didn't have the one I was looking for. It was for your, Nestor, for your mother, I believe. And we were looking for a Bible for your mother. I called up Dr. Chapman. I recommend everybody. You know why? He's a hero. I mean, any doctor that works on you and you live, he's a good doctor. If you die, he was a bad doctor. It's kind of like preachers. You know, if people get saved under his ministry, especially your family, he's a good preacher. But if your kids get mad and leave, he's a bad preacher. Amen, amen, amen. That's the way it works. Look at the merciful conclusion. When you begin to understand your condition, then you begin to understand God's mercy. If you got what you deserved, you'd be in the lake of fire today, wouldn't you? You'd be in jail also, wouldn't you? You see, all are under condemnation, but the wonderful thing is that all can become a child of God by faith. You see, when God put us all in the same category and said everybody's condemned, then he says, now I'm going to put everybody in the same category. You can be saved by accepting my son. Everybody's in the same category as being lost. No difference. Now God says, I'm going to put everybody in the same category and extend mercy to everybody with no lines of distinction. And then he says, any person by faith who will accept my offer, I'll forgive him. No distinction. None whatsoever. Makes no difference. In verse 22 it says, but the scripture hath concluded all under sin. Why? That the promise of faith of Jesus Christ might be given to all them that believe. Well, I'm thankful that I got saved when I was a boy. Let me ask you, are you saved? Are you really? You say, I was raised in a Christian home. I don't think that was the question. Are you saved? You say, I've been baptized. Didn't ask you if you were baptized. That's not the question. I said, are you saved? You said, well, I've said a prayer. I didn't ask you if you'd said a prayer. Are you saved? You say, well, I believe Jesus died on the cross. So does the devil. So does every cult in America. How many of you believe Jesus died on the cross before you got saved? Let me see your hand. Well, isn't that a rip? Look at that. All these people believe Jesus died on the cross before they were saved. They weren't even saved. You see, you don't get the picture. You can believe in the virgin birth and the blood atonement and the Bible being the infallible word of God and the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ and split hell wide open. The devil believes in God and trembles. He's smarter than most Baptists. At least he fears. Except a man is born again. Except he's born again. It's called regeneration. It's called the new nature. And you know why I know that many Baptists have never been born again? It's not because of what they say, necessarily. Because their life does not manifest or demonstrate one ounce of spiritual interest. None whatsoever. They don't pray. They don't read their Bible. They don't love God's people. They don't love what God loves. They don't love the body of Christ. They don't hate their own sinful nature. There's no struggle in their life. See, once you get saved, things change. And if things don't change, you may not be saved. I think the dog ought to know you're saved. I think the cat ought to know you're saved. I think now, instead of drop kicking him across the front yard, you throw him out. I think the cat. Well, now that's a different story. Tammy, is Tucker still here? Where are the Tuckers? Did they leave me? Oh, there they are, slipping toward the back. I've been talking about cats, okay. Anyway, no, I'm serious. I think that when we get saved, I think it changes in our treatment of animals. Don't you? See? Are you saved this morning? I am. I'm going to heaven when I die. And if the Lord tarries, die I will. And so will you. So since death is so certain, I suggest to you that you trust Christ as your Savior. Old Hank Williams used to sing a song. He said, no matter how I struggle and strive, I'll never get out of this world alive. Well, yes, you will. If you're saved, you get out of it alive. That's about the only way you're going to get out of it, is by being saved. I want to clarify something to those of you visiting today. Baptist people are no better than anybody else. You can be a Baptist and be lost. We're not any better than anybody. In some cases, we're worse than some people. So don't you misunderstand what I'm saying. I love all people. I'd like to see them all saved. But you can be a Baptist and be lost. I see Baptists get saved all the time. I've seen Baptist preachers get saved. Fellow been in the ministry. I've seen missionaries come home and get saved. See? So don't you misunderstand. Don't try to make me say something I'm not saying. I'm telling you that this is the authority. No pastor, no church, nobody. This book is the authority. And God hath concluded all of us, all around this pulpit, all of us, under condemnation. Why? Because we're sinners. But by doing that, he can offer mercy and grace to anybody who wants it. Now, I don't know if you want it or not. And if you don't, then you'll get the consequences. You'll get what you want. You'll get what you want. Let's bow in a word of prayer.